exclude ourselves.
Let's stand together.
We have some words.
And he was, as he was breaking in, getting ready to steal some things, he heard a voice said, "Stop. Jesus is watching you." And so he stopped and he looked around and it was a parrot that was saying this, "Stop. Jesus is watching you." He said, what's your name? And he said, "Well, my name's Moses." And he said, "Who would name their parrot Moses?" He said, "The same people who would name their 250-pound Rottweiler Jesus." Well, now that you're cheerful, we'll let you give. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. We thank you, Father, that you provide for us so that we can provide for the work that you're doing here and around the world. And Lord, tonight as we open your word together, we pray that you will edify us with your word through your Holy Spirit, that we will build, we will be built up so that we can encourage others. We pray now, Lord, that you take this offering, use it for your intended purposes, and we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, tonight I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles. I think I'm on, right? Am I on? Okay. I want to invite you to turn your Bibles to, we're going to look at several passages of Scripture. Probably the first place to turn will be 2 Corinthians 6. We're going to be looking at 1 and 2 Corinthians. We're going to be looking eventually. We're going to land in Ephesians chapter 5. And tonight we're continuing our little series, Moral Loopholes. You're on the blue side of your note sheet if you're looking to follow those. Red side was this morning. Blue side's tonight. And we're talking about moral loophole number 2, which is time. And how do we deal with that as we live our lives and many of the conflicts apparently that we see in our lives? How do we reconcile those things with God's word? The subtitle of this is The Dilemma and Danger for People Who Cannot Find Peace During Their Conflicted Time on Earth. And we're going to be looking at some of those conflicts. We're going to be looking at some of the paradoxes, three particular paradoxes tonight in the Christian life. Paradox, something that doesn't seem like it goes together, but yet it does go together. It does work. And there are things in our life that we look at and we say, you know, boy, I don't know how I can get a blessing out of that. I don't know how God can be glorified out of that, but yet he can. So first thing we're going to do is look at some of those paradoxes, and then after that we're going to look and see how we reconcile those things. I want you to look first in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verses 8 through 10. I just want to kind of point some of these out in that passage of Scripture that we see several here. Paul makes statements like this. He says that we are sorrowful, yet we are always rejoicing in one place. And then he says, we are as poor, yet making many rich in another place. And then he says, as having nothing, yet possessing everything. Now, those are three paradoxes right there that we can look at and say, wow, how do those go together? I mean, this is what I mean by paradoxes of the Christian life. Paul says he is sorrowful, yet he's always rejoicing. You know, how can you always be rejoicing if you're sometimes sorrowful? And there must be some kind of a sorrowful joy and some kind of a joyful sorrow that the believer can tap into. And indeed, there is one of the deep paradoxes of the Christian life that we face. How are we joyful in this sinful world? Paul says that he is having nothing, yet he's possessing everything. Martin Luther said it this way. He said, quote, a Christian is a perfectly free lord of all, subject of none. There's another paradox. A Christian is perfectly a dutiful servant of all, but yet they are subject to no one. In other words, when you are adopted into the royal family of God through faith in Jesus Christ, some of those same paradoxes that mark Jesus' life begins to mark our life as well, marks your life as well, having nothing yet possessing everything, subject to no man yet a servant to all. That was Jesus. And there's another place where Paul, and I want you to turn there with me, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 29 through 31, where Paul describes some of the paradoxes of the Christian life. 1 Corinthians 7, verses 29 through 31. He says this, this is what I mean, brothers. The appointed time has grown very short. From now on, let those who have wives live as though they had none. And those who mourn as though they were not mourning. And those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing. And those who buy as though they had no goods, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it, for the present form of this world is passing away. You know, if we obey these admonitions, if you will, from the apostle, then we husbands will love our wives with the faithfulness and firmness and tenderness of Christ, and yet there will be a sense in us that we have no wife. Those of us who grieve will grieve with a sense of pain and sorrow of the tragedy, but yet it will be as if there is no tragedy. And when we do business, according to this, when we do business with the world, we will do it as though we really have no dealings with the world. So the Christian life is basically living with many paradoxes, right? I mean, little by little, as we draw near to God, as we begin to serve Him, in every case, we only see things in part. The Bible says we see now through a glass dimly. We don't understand how all of these things fit together, but yet they fit together. But I don't think the Lord wants us to live with confusion. The Bible tells us that He is not the author of confusion. And so there must be some biblical understanding and explanation that we can gain tonight in looking at Scripture to say, how do we justify that? How do we live in victory with these paradoxes? So what I want to do tonight is focus our attention on our passage that I'm originally told you to turn to, Ephesians chapter 5 and verses 15 through 20. And we're going to focus there for now and try and draw some understanding of how we live with these paradoxes. Not just live with them. Not just survive. How do we thrive with these paradoxes? Ephesians 5, 15 through 20 says, "Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in the Lord with your hearts, or to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word, and we ask that you bless the reading of it and that you guide us now, Lord, for your glory and our good. We ask it in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, you know, I'm always, every time I read this passage of Scripture, you can just sense the tension in it. I mean, on the one hand, the text says, watch carefully how you live. In other words, you need to be alert, you need to be vigilant. It says, apply wisdom so that you redeem the time because, you know, the things that you have opportunity for now may never come again, so you need to redeem the time, for the days are evil. You know, opposition is not a bad thing. Opposition is great, but you need to be wise as serpents, the Bible tells us. Understand what the will of the Lord is. Don't surrender to the powers of false judgments of things like alcohol. So these words ring with a sense of urgency. They're like the words of a commander with an army that say you're getting ready to go into battle, and that commander is saying to you, hey, you need to be vigilant, and even if you're the most aggressive warrior there is, you're still nervous and your hands are sweating because you realize this is a big moment here. He's saying, watch your step, be smart, don't miss this opportunity, and keep yourself alert. Don't be distracted by things. And then we come to verses 18, second part of verse 18 through 20. And he says, be filled with the Spirit and sing to each other. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, and let your heart fill up with melody, where nobody, you know, God understands because he's listening to your heart. And it may be coming out of your mouth kind of rough, but God's listening to your heart, and it's beautiful music because it's thanksgiving unto the Father. Someone has written this about the text, quote, "It sounds like the war is over. The tension and vigilance of the conflict are gone. We're back home with the family. It's Thanksgiving Day. There's a fire in the fireplace and marshmallows on the skewers and a game spread out on the dining room table and sweet music is in the air." End of quote. And with that, we see the tension between several things. First, we see the tensions between time and eternity. Look again at verses 15 through 18. I mean, I see between urgency versus gratitude. The urgency is in verses 15 through 18 and the gratitude in verses 18 through 20. And we can break it up there into three parts. The first part we see is evil days and thanksgiving for everything. There are two paradoxes. There are evil days, but yet we're to be thankful for everything. You know, Paul's not some naive person here. He understands the evilness of the world. In Galatians chapter 1 and verse 4, he said that Christ gave himself for our sins to deliver us from this present evil age, this present darkness. The age is evil because God has given Satan so much of a leash that he's even been called in 2 Corinthians 4:4 the God of this age. And so we see that truly when he says the days are evil, it's a literal thing. The days are evil because Satan is very much alive. The age is evil because God allows so much pride and wickedness in the human heart to go unrestrained right now, even amongst the remnant of the church. The age is evil because so many natural catastrophes happen. There's so much suffering and injustice in the world. We don't have to look too far to see that the days are evil. And Paul knew all about this personally. I mean, Paul isn't just, he's not just talking about in theory. He's not an armchair critic here. I mean, you study the life of Paul. He talked about his own sin in Romans chapter 7. I mean, he felt the sins of the world, of this evil age, when he was stoned and when he was beaten with rods, when he was imprisoned. He went without food. He went without clothing. He went without shelter. He was harassed almost in every city he went into. He never knew when his life would be snuffed out by someone wanting to kill him. He suffered some kind of a chronic ailment, which no matter how many times he prayed that God would take it away, the Lord wouldn't take it away from him. One lesson he tells us in 2 Corinthians 12, verses 9 and 10, Christ told him that his power was made perfect in his weakness, in Paul's weakness. So Paul was given the grace in the midst of these evil days to make this statement, I will all the more gladly exalt in my weaknesses that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So we know it can be done. So we consider the evil days. Next, consider the thanksgiving. Look at verse 20. Ephesians 5, verse 20, he's not in some dream world here where all is easy and healthy and holy. He's not telling us to do any more than God had given him grace to do. But he says, be thankful for everything. Now notice what he says there. Be thankful, what's the next word? For everything. He doesn't say be thankful in everything. I mean, he actually says that in 1 Thessalonians 5:18. He says, be thankful in everything. But here he says, be thankful for everything. We have to be very careful here because he's not saying when you're thankful for everything, he's not saying go to a funeral and start dancing around the coffin. He's not saying that. He doesn't mean that you can't shed a tear as my wife did when she found out she had cancer twice. It doesn't say that there's no place for anger when we look at the world and we see the injustices of the world. It doesn't say that. But it does say always be thankful for everything. And this is the word of God. This is not merely the word of man. So God wants us to be thankful for everything. How do we do that? You know, if it puzzles us or if it even provokes us, we must not become cynical or rebellious about it. We should be like Mary. We're coming up on Christmas. We're going to hear all these accounts of the Christmas story again. And when Mary was told by the angel that she was pregnant, she knew she had never been with a man. We can respond as Mary. Mary said, how can this be? How can this be? And I love the answer that the angel Gabriel gave to her. He said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And then he says this, listen, with God, nothing will be impossible. And is that not the same answer that Paul would give to all the things that he faced and that we face in Ephesians 5? I mean, wouldn't he say from verse 18, it is beyond your understanding, it's beyond your emotional ability to give thanks to God for all things. And it comes with the filling of the Spirit of God, and we'll say more about that. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths, the deep things of God. 1 Corinthians 2:10. So if we trust God, if we have faith that God's still in control, even though there's things happening that we can't justify back and forth, he will unfold for you as an omnipotent, wise, all-wise, all-knowing Father. He will unveil that for us, the peace that we can have during that. And in heaven, we'll understand it. We'll see clearly then. But until then, we live by faith, not by sight. The days are evil, he says, but give thanks always for everything to God the Father. The second thing we see here is exploration and exaltation. Look at verses 15 and then verse 17. The second way we express of expressing these paradoxes of these verses is to say that we must live with the tension between exploration or analysis and exaltation because of what we have examined and what we see going on around us. Look again. Verse 15 says, look carefully then how you walk. Verse 17 says it a little differently. Do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. So together, these two verses call us to just careful, prayerful thought about what's going on in our life. Look carefully. Know yourself. Know your enemy. Know what God, your commander, is telling you to do. Know the situation. Apply the logic that God has given you. Look at these things. Explore. Ask the questions in your mind. Use your mind to scrutinize, to examine, to sort out the distinctions in whatever it is that's confusing you. Use your mind. God gave you a mind. Use it. That's what he's saying here. It's the exploration. Look carefully then how you walk. But understand what the will of the Lord is. So that's what I'm calling exploration. But there's a second part to it. There's exaltation. Because in verse 19, look what he says. Then verse 19 says that we should be full of exaltation. He says, make melody to the Lord in your hearts. Now, isn't that interesting? Our emotions, not just our minds, are engaged in what God's doing in our life. We don't just analyze, we don't just look at it, think through it, analyze it. As we do that, there should be a song welling up in our heart that we express exaltation to God for what it is. I'm looking at it, I'm examining it. I may not even understand it all, but I'm to exalt the Lord. We shouldn't just be content with the formulas and the theories of salvation and how God has our eternity set. We should be filled with thanksgiving that we are saved and we have eternity facing us. Now, as we look at this, we all understand that it's not easy to fit these two things together. This is a burdensome paradox for us, because the two states of mind don't fit easily together, exploration and exaltation. Exploration and the rigorous thought on the one hand, and the exaltation and the emotional thanksgiving on the other. I mean, this is why we get so concerned when our students go off to college and go off to grad school. This is why we get concerned about this. It's not just because they're going to be facing unbelieving professors and wrestling with secular ideas. It's because we know well that exaltation and thanksgiving can so easily be swallowed up by the exploration and the examination and the demands of academic work. We know that. But yet we see the paradox here. God has placed the paradox of both of them in our lives. That's why we should say to our students, hold on to the exploration, but also don't lose the exaltation. My challenge this evening for us is that we understand the powers of both and that God intentionally put them in the scripture together. So for the deep thinker who might be here tonight, if you are all cerebral with little emotion, don't brag about it, because it's not considered a badge of honor in heaven. In fact, it's a weakness, not a strength. You need to strive to nurture your heart's capacity for joy and expressing the emotional joy of what God is doing in your life, lest you be stunted forever and have just little joy going into eternity. So if you're a deep thinker, you need to consider the balance in your life. And I would also say for the deep emotional person tonight, if you're all emotions with little bent for studying God's word and analyzing things, don't brag about that either, because that too is a weakness. It's not a strength. Strive to nurture your mind's capacity for thinking and understanding the word of God and the work of God and what he's doing. They go together here. Don't surrender the paradox. Don't let go of it. If you let go of one and you just cling to the other, if you say, I'm just going to be all intellectual, then you're losing what God has for you by putting this paradox in here. If you say, I'm just going to be emotional and I'm just going to live for the moment and just love Jesus, we become lukewarm. We need to hold to the paradox that God has given us. Now notice here, he says that the days are evil. So we have evil days and thanksgiving for everything, number one. Number two, we have exploration and exaltation. And the third and last one here is we have wartime vigilance and peacetime praise. There's another paradox. The third way of describing the paradox of these verses is to say that we have to live with the tension of being vigilant at war spiritually, but at the same time being a thankful people who are at total peace. Or another way to say it, that we must be careful about our walk in this world, to be vigilant with that, but yet we need to be carefree concerning the outcomes of our life and what God is doing. First, consider the vigilance. Look at verse 15. He says, look carefully how you walk. You can see it in verse 16. Look at verse 16. Since the days are evil, be alert how you can snatch up, in one translation, snatch up every opportunity for good. You can see it in verse 17. Don't be foolish. Apply your mind, he says. Think through what is the will of God. In other words, we're to be a vigilant people because we're at war spiritually. But then consider the paradox in that we're to be thankful and at peace. You know what amazes me about verse 19 is not that we are supposed to sing songs of thanks to God, but basically what he's saying here, if you read this literally, is we're to have a musical heart, not so much musical gift here of being able to sing on the note. I think that's why it says make a joyful noise unto the Lord, because that joyful noise comes out of your heart, out of the abundance of the heart. The mouth speaks, the mouth sings. You know, the picture here for us in this passage of Scripture, if we were to illustrate it out, it's as if I would come here and say, folks, there is a regiment of our enemies who are outside of the church. They are armed, and their purpose is to come in. They hate God. They hate Christianity. They believe we're wrong, and they're going to attack us, and they're going to put us to death. So open your hymnals, and we're going to rejoice and sing unto the Lord. That's pretty much what he's saying here. We have to be able to do that. How is that? And please don't miss this. The reason is because it's an inside-out singing. It's not an outside-in singing. It's an inside-out singing. Not only are we singing outwardly with our mouth, we are inwardly singing with our heart. This is what I mean when I say that we should be a thankful people at rest with God. Our hearts should be carefree about the outcomes of our life. This is what Paul says happens when a person becomes a Christian. There's a paradox that's born. Vigilance and carefulness in the way we live our lives, lest we gain an upper hand, or the enemy gains an upper hand. Carefree, restless. 1 Thessalonians 5:24 says, "He who called you is faithful, and he will do it." We have to hold on to these paradoxes because God has called us. God is the one who's given them to us. That's why so many of us get frustrated with the seeker-sensitive church movement. Because there's such a heavy, heavy focus upon just the missional aspect of Christianity and the emotional aspect of Christianity without the thinking part of Christianity. And so many of those ministries, they're an inch deep and a mile wide. And we have to guard against the other. We don't want to just become such students of the Word of God and know the doctrines of the Word of God that we miss. And I think there's a good balance here. I truly believe that. Not just because this is the church where I am. But we have to guard against that. We cannot let go of the paradoxes. So what is the glue that holds it all together? The paradox between living in evil days and being thankful for everything. The paradox between rigorous exploration and thankful exaltation. The paradox between being vigilant people at war at the same time being thankful people at peace. Well, the glue that holds it together is in verse 18. Look what he says. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit. He's saying there's something greater than alcohol that will give you peace. You know, as a side note, I was reading an article this week, and when I was reading this passage again, I think it kind of illustrates it. The article was and was studies on alcohol and music and how music, today's popular music, goes together. I'm just going to read you some of this. I mean, it's a long, long article, but I'm not going to read you the whole thing. Today's music is full of references to alcohol and often even celebrates excessive drinking as fun and beneficial activity. In fact, a study conducted by Northwestern University found that 22.4% of songs on the Billboard's top 100 list mentioned alcohol. Another study by Boston University and Johns Hopkins University looked at Billboard's listings of the most popular songs from 2009 to 2011. They identified 720 songs with a whopping 167 or 23.2% of them mentioning alcohol. Data from the research performed by BU and Johns Hopkins showed that the three music genres that had the most alcohol-centered music were as follows. Number one was hip-hop and rap. Number two was country. And number three was pop. Themes of alcohol use were most apparent in rap and hip-hop music. These genres accounted for 37.7% of the songs that mentioned alcohol and most frequently referenced tequila, vodka, cognac, and champagne. Country music was second, with 32% of mentions being found in country songs, mostly mentioning beer and whiskey. Third was pop music, with 30.5% of the mentions. So how does alcohol in music influence use? Some would say little. Well, it's not so, according to this. Popular culture plays a significant role in people's lives. According to the social learning model, people learn, the article says, not only by direct experience, but also by exposure to model behavior. such as the represented in popular music. Individuals that are exposed to representations of drinking and alcohol use are more likely to engage in those behaviors themselves if they are represented in a positive light and associated with desirable affluences. How's this for proof? No pun intended. A study performed by the School of Public Health found that among Billboard's most popular song lists recently, there were four liquor brands that appeared with a surprising frequency. According to the study, the brands' names were associated with wealth 63.4% of the time, sex 58.5% of the time, luxury objects 51.2% of the time, partying 48.8% of the time, and other drugs 43.9% of the time, and vehicles, cars, automobiles, 39% of the time. These brands all had a spike in sales while the songs were mentioned on the top charts. One specific brand mentioned in a popular song prompted a 310% increase in sales that year that totaled to $61 million. Although music may not directly cause people to drink, the article says, it can foster an increase of alcohol use due to social and cultural influences. Alcohol is in music is often associated with fun, power, money, respect, and sexual relationships, which can all cause listeners to use alcohol in an effort to emulate their favorite musicians. And finally, what about at-risk youth? The study showed that young people are at particular risk of being negatively influenced by alcohol and music. Listen, for every hour that an American teen listens to music, he or she will hear more than three references to brand name alcohol. That's about 34 in the course of a day. Popular music has a large role, it says, in socializing what is and isn't cool for teenagers and adolescents, and the exposure of young people to alcohol and music is a major concern. At least 14 long-term studies have shown that heavy exposure to alcohol marketing and media increases the likelihood that young people will start drinking or, if already drinking, consume more. I could go on and on and on. So it's with good reason that Paul says in verse 18 there, and do not get drunk with wine, for it is debauchery, but he doesn't leave it there. He says, but be filled with the Spirit. Why does he say that? The reason he says that is because if you will do that, then God will uncover for you the peace that you need during a vigilant wartime. He will uncover for you the paradox and of the rigorous exploration and the exaltation. He will let you hold on to those paradoxes and not let go of one. And he will unveil the paradox for you for living in evil days and being thankful for everything that you're facing. The mystery of gratitude for all things, even in the days that are evil. The pleasures of exaltation, even in the midst of your analysis. And the peace that passes all understanding, even in the vigilance of our daily conflict of facing the evil of this world. Urgency and gratitude, they're glued together in one heart by the work of the Holy Spirit, not the things that this world tries to hold things together with. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. And Father, as we leave the church building this evening and prepare for another week, God, we pray that you would help these things to be evident in us. Yea, even self-evident through the power of the Holy Spirit. And Father, that we would understand that these apparent conflicts are given to us so that we can be well-rounded for you. And that one day all of these things will be made clear to us. Thank you for the free salvation that we have through Christ. Thank you that you have all things under your hand and under your feet. And Lord, thank you that we can trust you and that you never leave us or forsake us. And as we talk this morning, Father, may we go out and evangelize the lost world. May we share our faith with others as we go our way. May you lead people to us so that we can help them to see the benefit, the eternal benefit of being redeemed back to a God who we have wronged and having our sins forgiven. We ask these things, Lord, in the name of your Son, Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Well, I'm going to let you out on good behavior. So go ahead and let's stand and we'll sing a closing song. What's a little chorus? Help me, my brain's fried. Anybody? What? Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation so rich and free. Have a great week.